Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's virtual In Conversation program. My name is Christy McMillan, and I'm the Director of Learning and Engagement here at the Asheville Art Museum. We've all made a lot of changes over the past year. As most of you know, the museum has shifted much of our programming to the virtual realm. While we've missed engaging with you in the galleries, one silver lining that has come from this time apart has been the opportunity to bring them to the museum, bring the museum to folks near and far, from Asheville, Western North Carolina, across the state, country, and around the world, and to feature special guests that we might not have been able to in pre-COVID times. This chance opens up our ability to richly interpret the artwork in our collection and special exhibitions through a range of voices and points of view. We have a number of evening In Conversation programs coming up that I'll mention to you at the end of tonight's program. This month, we're thrilled to welcome our colleague, Carrie Springer. Carrie curated our current special exhibition, Vantage Points, Contemporary Photography from the Whitney Museum of American Art, which has been a source of delight for in-person visitors and a fertile ground for conversation and virtual programming for participants of all ages. This evening's program features an overview of Vantage Points, plus a discussion between Carrie and our site curator about what it takes to adapt exhibitions conceptualized for one institution in another museum space. During the program, please add any questions or comments that you have to the chat box, and we'll leave time at the end of the evening for Q&A. Now, please join me to welcome Hillary Schroeder, the museum's assistant curator, and Carrie Springer from the Whitney.
Good evening, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us for tonight's program. It's my pleasure to introduce our speaker, Carrie Springer. Carrie joined the Whitney Museum of American Art in 2002. As assistant curator, she has organized quite an exciting and interesting list of exhibitions and facilitates acquisitions for the Whitney's permanent collection. Most recently, she's worked on the Whitney's presentation of Working Together, the Photographers of the Kamwea Workshop, organized by the Virginia Museum of Fine Arts. She also organized a traveling exhibition here on view at the Asheville Art Museum, Vantage Points, Contemporary Photography from the Whitney Museum, which was also shown at the Peoria Riverfront Museum. She's also organized the exhibition Robert Rauschenberg, Five Decades from the Whitney's Collection at the Norton Museum of Art. At the Whitney in 2018, she organized an exhibition from the permanent collection of Harold Edgerton photographs. She was part of the curatorial team for Frank Stella, a retrospective, and she curated Edward Steichen and the 1920s and 1930s, a recent acquisition. She also collaborated on Sherry Levine, Mayhem, worked with Robert Gober on the Whitney presentation of Heat Waves in a Swamp, the paintings of Charles Birchfield, and curated Photography in the South, the Legacy of F. Holland Day. So lots of curating of photography, which makes her a great person to be talking to tonight about this wonderful exhibition she's put together. She's also provided assistance on numerous exhibitions on artists such as Yayoi Kusama, Richard Tuttle, and Kiki Smith. She first joined the Whitney in 2002 to work on the exhibition and catalog for the paintings of Joan Mitchell and Visions from America 1940 to 2001. She currently serves the Whitney on their Art and Indigenous Culture Working Group. Please join me in welcoming Carrie Springer.
Thank you so much, and good evening, everyone. Thanks for joining. Before I begin, I want to thank Pamela Myers, Executive Director, Hillary Schroeder, Assistant Curator, and Christy McMillan, Director of Learning and Engagement, and all the Asheville Art Museum staff for your interest and wonderful work in bringing this exhibition to Asheville. The Vantage Points exhibition is drawn entirely from the Whitney's permanent collection, and it grew out of a desire to look more closely at a group of remarkable photographs that were very generously given to the museum by Emily Fisher Landau. They were part of her collection, and the gift and promise gift included a number of photographic works from the 1970s to the 2000s. That provide a window into what was a significant shift in the use of photography. The exhibition expanded somewhat from that gift and includes additional works from the museum's collection that share and elaborate on some of the thematic threads that I found within the gift. I'm going to talk this evening a little about the backstory of how the show came together and how it's organized, and then I'll highlight some of the works in the exhibition. It became clear as I looked at the Emily Fisher Landau gift that it reflected deep changes in photography as an art form, and that it also reflected the Whitney's own approach to collecting. As I'm sure you all know, photography was not always widely accepted as an art form, and certainly not on a par with other media. It has a history of its own, and that was not integrated into the larger discourse around art history for quite some time. By the 1970s, that was starting to shift, and artists who were not strictly speaking photographers began to use the camera in different ways. Next slide, please. Actually, I'm a slide behind. This is the Whitney Museum in the evening. And here we are. This is William Eggleston, a work that's in the exhibition. While this image may not seem particularly radical, William Eggleston's work, and more significantly, the Museum of Modern Art's William Eggleston retrospective in 1976, had a strong impact on this shift in photography. That was particularly because it was color photography as opposed to black and white, and partially because Eggleston's extraordinary color images depicted everyday objects, moments, and places from a new perspective, one that highlighted the unremarkable and often banal in the everyday environment. Part of the shift in photography was also due to technological developments. Photographic equipment became much more user-friendly and inexpensive. Next slide, please. Polaroid cameras were available and used by non-professionals and by artists as diverse as people like Walker Evans, who was known best for his black and white images, and artists like Andy Warhol. Color photography in general became more accessible and inexpensive. Artists who knew nothing about apertures and f-stops or anything about developing film and printing from negatives could buy a relatively inexpensive camera, take a photograph, and have it developed, either in front of their eyes, as with a Polaroid image, or by a commercial lab. And it didn't cost a fortune. The possibility also opened up for having photographic prints made in various sizes, such as the very large prints by Robert Longo, next slide please, that are in the Vantage Points exhibition. So instead of peering into a work on the wall, you could stand in front of it and feel completely immersed in the image. It also became possible to print an image and affix it to a three-dimensional object that you could walk around. Next slide, please. Like this Richard Archwager piece. As different photographic processes also became available to artists, they began looking into various possibilities available to them and experimenting with the medium in order to make representations of the world or some part of it in diverse ways. All of these technical changes encouraged experimentation, including the use of some very old techniques that were used in new ways. Next slide, please. Vera Luder made this image with a camera obscura. And many of you have probably made a simple camera obscura at some point, but if not, it's basically a box or other structure with an aperture on one side and a surface on the other, where the external scene, which is in front of the aperture, is projected and projected upside down. For this work, Luder constructed a large camera obscura and put photosensitive paper on the back wall, opposite the aperture or the pinhole. With that, she created a black and white negative that she then developed into a unique print, keeping the tonal values reversed so that the daytime sky appears black and the buildings white. The technical changes and possibilities, the experimentation and expanded use of photography by artists and art directors, and the prevalence of printed imagery in magazines, newspapers, products, and television led more and more artists to question issues of authenticity and to become aware of the use of photography as a fictional or a conceptual device and as a way to create a certain kind of impact rather than as a documentary tool. Next slide, please. This image by Baldessari from the exhibition questions the perception of images and their connection to language. It highlights the context that text brings to images. And by using an appropriated image with words or phrases, and in this case, color too, Baldessari used photography towards a more conceptual end. All these shifts in photography during this period were very evident in the works given to the museum by Emily Fisher Landau. They also coincided with important aspects of the Whitney's own collection. The Whitney's priorities and perspective on photography was unlike its sister institutions in New York, such as the Metropolitan Museum or the Museum of Modern Art. And the Vantage Points exhibition reflects that particular perspective very closely. The Whitney's focus was and still very much is on photography as part of the creative thinking of artists. Next slide, please. This began very early on in the museum's history with artists like Charles Sheeler, who was an extraordinary photographer as well as a painter and is certainly best known for his paintings. Next slide. That focus continues to the present with artists like Richard Archwager and others who work in various media. And of course, Richard Archwager is fairly recently deceased, but this continues to the present. On the left, you see a work made with commercial materials, in this case for mica and Celotex. And on the right is his three-dimensional piece in Vantage Points called Charisse. There has also been at the Whitney a focus on photography as a thematic investigation of the world in which we live. Next slide, please. Such as this work by Melissa Ann Pinney, who is best known for her long-term series regarding Emma, Photographs of American Women and Girls. Since the 1980s, Pinney has created an extensive and very important body of work that reflects on the development and transmission of female identity within our patriarchal society, highlighting both the poignant and the humorous aspects of that, as in this wonderful image. The Whitney's collection also includes photography that represents ideas about photographic representation and how it can evoke something about an individual or a shared sense of identity or experience. Next slide, please. This work by Lorna Simpson combines photographs and text to create a suite of references. The text on the left is meant to be completed by the words on the right. And each of those compound words represents either a physical state or kind of condition that suggests experiences shared by many African-American women. Through the use of text and image, this work encourages a narrative in the mind of the viewer, who brings their own thoughts and associations to the work. With all this in mind, I started to look at the connections between the individual photographs in the Emily Fisher Landau gift and the conversations that arose in my mind between the works. What I saw is the despite many differences between each of the artists. The photographs had three general qualities in common, and many of those qualities overlapped. Some of the photographs depict individuals and the artist-owned community, and some depict a strong spirit of place, and others suggest or imply a type of narrative or story, not necessarily a precise one, but a narrative nonetheless. It was my sense and my hope that these connections would offer a starting point or a point of reference to enter into the space of looking and thinking about the works. Next slide. I'd like to speak briefly about a few of the works from each section, beginning with photographs of individuals and the artists' communities. This work is a work by Peter Hujar, and Peter Hujar's work is a wonderful example of that. This photograph of Susan Sontag from 1975 that's in the exhibition. Hujar is perhaps best known for his intimate black and white portraits that were shot in New York City in the 1970s and 1980s. Many of his subjects were artists, musicians, film, theater, and dance luminaries. Although Hujar was part of a very vibrant and experimental downtown art scene, his photographs have both an unconventional quality and also a very classical quality to them. Many of his portraits were shot in his loft as friends and acquaintances sat in a chair or relaxed on his bed. His portraits are very direct. The figures are often in the center of the composition and they're beautifully printed. Hujar printed them himself. In 1976, he published his first book titled Portraits in Life and Death, which included a selection of portraits of living subjects followed by photographs he had made in 1963 of the catacombs in Palermo, Italy. Susan Sontag wrote an introduction to that book and commented on Hujar's awareness of the balance between life and death. She wrote that his portraits of friends, and I'll quote, appear to meditate on their own mortality, end quote. Her own portrait, the one you see here, is included in the book, as well as the next slide, please, which is a self-portrait of Hujar, which is also in the Vantage Points exhibition. And you can see that the relaxed, reclining, thoughtful pose of his self-portrait is very similar to the one of Susan Sontag. As many of you may already know, Hujar was diagnosed with AIDS in 1987. And died later that year from complications related to the disease. So Sontag's comment on his meditation on mortality is very apt in his portraits of himself and others. Next slide, please. The suite of Andy Warhol photographs in the exhibition came from what Warhol called a family album. It was given to the museum by the Andy Warhol Foundation. And for this exhibition, I selected 16 images from the album, which has a total of 853 works. The Whitney's album includes Polaroids and small photographs that Warhol took of his friends and acquaintances, most of whom were artists, designers, directors, and personal friends. Many of the people in this selection are those who traveled to Rome with him in the early 1970s when the films Flesh for Frankenstein and Blood for Dracula, for which Warhol was a producer, were being shot. When Warhol used a Polaroid camera, he often asked his subjects to autograph the photograph, and some of these autographs are visible in the exhibition. If you see writing on them, that's most likely his friend's writing. As you probably know, photography was an essential part of Warhol's working process, and it also was a way he connected creatively to a circle of friends and acquaintances, most of whom were very accomplished individuals and part of his cultural milieu. Next slide, please. This image is Jed Johnson, who was a partner of Warhol's at the time and an extraordinary designer. And he's holding Warhol's dog, Archie, in what I think is an incredibly beautiful and tender photograph, qualities we don't normally associate with Warhol. And just as an aside, Warhol brought Archie with him to Italy. Next slide, please. Another image in this section of the exhibition is by Nan Golden, called Amanda on My Fortuny, Berlin. Throughout her career, Nan Golden has photographed intimate moments in her own life, as well as the lives of those around her. By using a kind of diaristic approach to photography, she created a chronicle of her relationships and also created an unflinching view of the emotional lives of her friends and loved ones. In the 1980s, her photographs captured raw, almost tragic, and poignant moments that reflected a sense of pleasure, intimacy, and sometimes the harsh effects of drug use and painful traces of physical abuse. However, in the 1990s, in images like this one of Amanda, Golden began to use natural light, and her imagery became much more subdued and was imbued with a sense of wonder and tenderness. Next slide, please. Another work that represents individuals and communities is this one by Catherine Opie called Mike and Sky from 1992. Opie's portraits from this period are also somewhat classical and formal in their approach. The subjects are looking forward at the camera with a solid background behind them, and their format is almost reminiscent of historic portrait paintings. However, much like other artists in the exhibition, Opie has photographed her own friends and community, and in doing so, emphasizes the intimacy and power of individuals and relationships within the American LGBTQ community. Next slide, please. Lyle Eschen Harris has used photography as well as performance, film, and installations to examine the social constructs of race, gender, and sexual identity. He's perhaps best known for his own self-portraits and the use of iconic figures from popular culture, figures like Billie Holiday, to explore issues around identity and fame, as well as a connection between what may be personal and more cultural and political. The work and vantage points is this one you see called Lyle London from 1992. And it includes Harris's own image in bed with a poster of Derek Jarman's film, Caravaggio, hanging above and behind the bed. As you probably know, Caravaggio was an influential Italian Baroque painter who lived on the cusp of the 16th and 17th centuries and who had a very dramatic life story that ended with his death at the age of 39. Harris's photograph here includes his own representation in conversation with that figure, an artist who had a profound impact on generations of artists in various ways, perhaps most importantly for his ability to portray emotional and physical aspects of the human condition. And of course, this is not really Caravaggio we're seeing, but a film poster depicting Caravaggio. Next slide, please. In addition to photographs of individuals, many works in the Vantage Points exhibition evoke a strong spirit of place, such as Richard Avedon's portrait of Bill Curry. The title refers to Curry as a drifter and very specifically notes where Avedon encountered or photographed Curry. Although this is clearly a photograph of an individual, so it may seem strange, I've put it in this section, I would suggest that it actually speaks more clearly about a quality or idea of place than about the man himself. Abaddon is best known for very elegant photographs of fashion and portraits of people in the arts and fashion. However, he was commissioned for this project, which is titled In the American West. He was commissioned by the Amon Carter Museum. For this series, he made photographs of many people over multiple trips to the Western United States. I think he went to 13 states over the course of about 5 years, and made a total of about 124, narrowed it down to about 124 different images. Each subject was placed in front of a white backdrop, like you see here, which was Avedon's signature way of making portraits. This portrait suggests the environment in which a kind of mythic story plays out of rugged individualism among colonial American settlers who inhabit what we call the Western frontier. So you might see this image as telling a story or having a narrative, but for me, the man's clothing, hair, and posture, Avedon's title, and the size of this print, which is very large, bring to mind a very palpable feeling of place, of a landscape and the spirit of place where this man comes from or is traveling to. Next slide, please. Among the representations of place are also works such as this one, William Eggleston's photograph of the boy in the red sweater. Eggleston's photographs of everyday or common place moments, he basically transformed into memorable images with deep ties to a spirit of place. He was born in Memphis and raised in Sumner, Mississippi, and his work is often associated with the South. He was not, however, attempting to document a location or tell a specific narrative or story. Rather, his photographs are reflective of his own perceptions of his environment. And although he's often photographed the commonplace, his perspective is unexpected. This photograph from the exhibition is an image of Eggleston's oldest son standing on the side of a road that appears to extend endlessly behind him. The light on the boy, the ominous sky, and the boy's buttoned-up sweater suggest a very particular temperature and moment, as does the relative isolation of the boy and the unmowed field where he's standing on the side of the road. The image has a very interesting emotional resonance that wavers between a hint of loneliness or melancholy and an underlying sense of connection. This ambiguity is a characteristic that I think is visible in American landscape in general, and an aspect of Eggleston's work that I find particularly compelling. Next slide, please. A very different sense of place occurs in Rodney Graham's work, which you see here. Since the mid-1970s, Rodney Graham has created a wide-ranging body of work that includes film, video, installation, painting, and music, as well as photography. He began to photograph trees in 1976, and in 1979, he created a camera obscura to photograph a tree in rural British Columbia. For his work in this particular series, which is Oxfordshire Oaks from the fall of 1990, in the Vantage Points exhibition, Graham photographed individual trees with a large format camera, and then he inverted the print for display. The upside down photograph brings to mind the way images are inverted in a camera obscura and encourages a reflection on the mechanical process of photography, as well as the human process of seeing, the way images are formed on the human retina and processed within the body and mind. In many ways, this suggests that our sense of place resides both within and outside of our own body. Next slide, please. One of the most compelling suites of photographs of place in the exhibition is Carrie Mae Weems' works from the Sea Island series, which suggests that history is embedded in place and in the land. By combining documentary as well as storytelling techniques, Weems has produced a body of work that addresses the complex and intertwined legacies of race, gender, and class, and their connection to the land. The untitled works from her Sea Island series, which are from 1991 to 92, evoke the legacy of the Gulag culture, which developed off the coast of South Carolina and Georgia from descendants of various groups in West Africa that were brought to the United States as slaves in the 17th century and forced to work on plantations in the area. Traces of the Gulag culture remain, and Weems's untitled images affirm the enduring links between the Gulag and their traditional belief systems, specifically folklore concerning spirituality and nature. In one of the photographs, the one on the far left, we see a bedspring wedged into the fork of a tree, an arrangement that the artist explained is meant to ensnare evil spirits. Weems' straightforward depiction isn't meant to be strictly documentary, but rather is a rich evocation of the past and the remnants of its spirit in the present. Next slide, please. The last slide from that I'm showing from this section is this one, image by Sally Mann. And Sally Mann photographed girls and young women in their everyday life in the 1980s and 90s. And Mann's early books were highly influential. Her first book, At 12, from 1988, was a photographic study of 12-year-old girls who, while still vulnerable as children, enter a kind of cultural adulthood. Mann's photographs of children, she photographed children of her friends and her own family, depict a kind of in-between stage in the lives, in their lives, where they mimic or begin to take on the appearance of adulthood. In the same decade, Mann photographed her own children at play in a series of photographs that became the book Immediate Family from 1992. And captured similar qualities while examining a sense of purity and freedom of childhood exploration. Next slide, please. The last thread in the Vantage Points exhibition, and one that often combines aspects of the other two sections, is focused on narrative. Melissa Ann Penny's photograph in the exhibition is from her long-term series that explores the development and transmission of female identity within American society. Penny has photographed the everyday lives of girls and women, including her own daughter, Emma, in the midst of familiar rituals, such as weddings, that are deeply rooted in tradition and long considered rites of American womanhood. Penny's photographs often portray generations of women, as this photograph does, in ways that call to mind the approach and sometimes the subject matter from painting and iconography of Penny's Catholic girlhood. At the same time, her work is clearly contemporary and is infused with a sense of intimacy, respect, and often humor. Next slide, please. Another photograph in this section of the exhibition is this one by Cindy Sherman, who is perhaps best known for her groundbreaking untitled film stills that were made between 1977 and 80 that feature the artist and as various characters from old B movies or foreign films. Sherman has photographed herself over the years in inventive and diverse ways. And by altering her hair, clothing, and makeup, she's depicted herself in wide-ranging roles, thereby exploring some of the ways in which identity and ideas about womanhood are constructed. how they're portrayed, and how we actually perceive them. Next slide, please. Gregory Crudson credits a wide range of influences in his work, including the painter Edward Hopper and the filmmaker Alfred Hitchcock. For his photographs, Crudson constructs elaborate tableaux or sets and stages actors with art directors and costume designers. These scenes are typically set in suburban American streets and are cinematically lighted. The effect is an image that is infused with surreal overtones and a sense of complicated emotional backstories and impending drama. His photographs blend a narrative quality with a kind of clarity and stillness of the moment. It's a fascinating and compelling dichotomy. Next slide, please. Finally, the last image I want to present this evening is Matthew Barney's drawing Restraint, Occidental Guest, on the left Bride and on the right Groom from 2005. Barney creates extremely elaborate and intensely personal mythologies, narratives, and symbols in his work. Drawing Restraint is a multimedia film project that's composed of 19 numbered components that include videos, sculptural installations, drawings, and photographs. The Drawing Restraint film is essentially a love story that takes place on a Japanese whaling ship. In these two classical formal portraits, as in the film, Barney and his life partner at the time, Bjork, dressed in fanciful, quasi-traditional clothing, play the Occidental guests at a tea ceremony on board the ship. As the film narrative progresses, the two characters fall in love and are slowly transformed from land to sea mammals. Barney's earlier well-known epic series, Cremaster Cycle, not from 1994 to 2002, is a very cryptic multimedia project that, like much of his work, is infused with multiple references, including to pop culture, mythology, aspects of American history, and the artist's own personal history. Barney's photographs aren't production stills, but are fully staged images that reflect the obscure and performative nature of his work. So in closing, I want to emphasize that the range of expression and form within the medium of photography continues to expand. And the vantage point or perspective that this exhibition provides into the works that are included is only one way to approach their resonance. I hope that by seeing them in this context, you'll have an experience of the works that will expand well beyond the exhibition and confines of the museum. So I hope you'll be able to see the exhibition in person, and if you haven't already, and that if you're in New York City, you'll come visit the Whitney Museum of American Art. Thank you, and looking forward to Hillary's presentation on the exhibition as well.
Thank you so much for that insight into the exhibition and how it came together. And we've got some questions pulled aside, actually, that we'll get to after I talk a little bit about bringing the exhibition here to the Asheville Art Museum. I'm excited to be able to talk about this a little bit because I feel like it's a bit of a mystery how an exhibition ends up on a museum's walls. And so this is a great chance to take a really specific answer to, or opportunity to look at how that happens. So give me just a second to get things set up here. And oops. I think if I am co-host, I should hopefully be able to share my screen. Yes. Okay. So this is a little bit of a behind the scenes peek that everyone's going to get tonight, which I hope is fun for everyone. There's a couple of ways that we work here at the Asheville Art Museum on planning for exhibitions, and one of those is on a half-inch scale model to our actual gallery spaces. So it's almost like a tiny dollhouse that we get to take these small versions of the works in an exhibition and play with laying them out and thinking about how we might organize them and show them to everyone when they come into the space itself. It was a real delight to work with Carrie on this exhibition. I love the contents of it. And I think that she did a really wonderful job in terms of sort of organizing it around these guiding ideas, these main concepts of people and place and narrative that made it really easy to fit this exhibition that had been curated from works not in our collection, not coming from our museum, and to bring them here to our space and make them really tell the same story with that same vision that Carrie put them together with. And so the process sort of started with me spending a little time with the checklist of objects that we were going to be getting. And then I had a wonderful phone call with Carrie where she talked me through the various objects and how she saw them fitting into the different categories. And as Carrie mentioned, there's a lot of fluidity between the different works and the group, like the categories in which you can place them. And so Carrie gave me a lot of freedom to really explore some of those works that might go in one place or another, and to honor those works that maybe were transitional in between various themes. And so I was able to take our little scale model here and begin to play with those ideas, not having seen the work, not, you know, knowing how they look on the wall next to each other, which Carrie was wonderfully helpful in saying after me sending her these very pictures, have you thought about maybe putting this next to this? I know that looking at these two works together is actually really great in person. And so that helped to sort of guide our planning. So if you've been to our space, this is where you walk into the gallery here, into sort of that smallest space. So this is sort of the journey that takes you through that gallery. And you'll note from looking at these images to the installation photographs I'm going to show you in a minute that there were some changes, right? We do our best to plan, but there is something about the magic that happens when you're in a space with the objects and they start to truly talk to each other. I know that sounds really cheesy, but it's true. They some of them just seem like they want to be next to each other or don't want to be next to each other. And one of the things that was particularly exciting and challenging about this exhibition was the scale. There is a lot of very, very large work in this exhibition. And so finding something that felt like a good fit for those works within our space, height-wise, width-wise. You'll see in this first one here, one of the big changes is I had tucked this work into a nook that in my mind, I was like, it's gonna be perfect. It's gonna sit in there great. And as soon as we got into the space with everything, it was like, oh, we need to give that a lot more breathing room. So we started here and then we eventually found our way to what I think is fairly close to what Carrie and I had originally talked about and what I had laid out in the model, but with those really subtle changes to bring the various works into a cohesive story, basically, from when you walk into the space. So I set it up so that you walked into the people section of things, because I think there's something just so relatable about these works. We've all sort of had these moments of connecting with people through photography of our communities. And I really love how there's these threads of community and friendship, even when they're individuals in the photograph, like the Nan Golden photographs, it's still a larger story of her greater community that she was within. And as with these communities, there are many stories that come with them. They take place in a very specific location, and yet, you know, they really can kind of go into all of those categories. And I love how the narrative category of their thematic part of this exhibition brings together the elements of people and place in such a lovely way. And that's just, yeah, it's a really interesting process, I think, to take the vision of someone else and try to translate it into a space that is different from where it originated. But I think exciting and what makes it special to even see, if you were to go to the Whitney and to see these works on the wall there, in almost maybe the exact same exhibition, it still would be a very different experience than seeing them in another location because of the context of where you are, your own sort of people, place, narrative part of the experience. And so you can see here the this large work, actually, I had planned to have it over here on the wall where one of the Matthew Barney Craymaster photographs is at, and the John Baldessari. We had to shift just to give it that proper sort of breathing space. And feel free to hop in if you've got any thoughts or observations, Carrie, but I've just got a couple more views just for folks who maybe haven't had a chance to see the exhibition yet or have come to see it and just don't mind the refresher of seeing it again. I do encourage folks to come and see it in person if you feel comfortable and experience these works and their richness in person. These William Eggleston photographs, which we've grouped together here, are really just lush in the color. And I know a lot of photographers that I've talked to, people who are practicing photographers, just love so many of the works in this exhibition because of the consideration of process and storytelling and perspective. And that Richard Avedon photograph, when you get up close to it, the detail is almost overwhelming how crisp and clear and vibrant it is. And so I know Carrie talked about how that work sits into a different category or theme based on what angle you come to it with. And so I wanted to place it somewhere in the exhibition where it was very close to both the people and the narrative section and yet still grounded in this idea of place. And I really love something like this Avedon photograph to recalibrate how we think about place, that we can use some of these as ways to consider how artists have tried to use modes that seem familiar to make us think in a different way. I would never have immediately put this work into a sense of place. And yet once Carrie and I talked about it and we talked about the context in which it was made, it was like, this is so clearly a snapshot of a moment of a particular spot that Avedon had stopped at out on his journey across the western part of the country. And yes, you will see these very large photographs by Graham, as well as the two other large works. So some things, like I said, were dictated by space, and those tree photographs they needed that whole wall to just have their moment. And to stand in front of this is really, really quite an experience, and to just contemplate and sort of meditate on the group of all four together. And so, yeah, that sort of just takes us through the exhibition at a very quick click, but I do hope that folks will stop back through the museum and visit sometime very soon to see these works in person, or come back and see it again, too. Always worth a repeat visit. So I think we might have a couple of questions, unless you want to chat a little bit about the process of sort of planning for an exhibition to leave after you've spent all this time working on it and then letting it go out into the world, putting it in the hands of someone else.
I just want to say you did a beautiful job. It really looks great. And congratulations. And I just want to kind of second what you said about seeing the works in person and what that and how different that is. And you know, it's really hard in these times when we're doing things like this program remotely, because the experience of these works is very different on a screen than it is when you stand in front of them. And so many of these works, like you talked about the Graham, when you stand in front of those, it's just such a profound experience. And even though I talked about them in terms of a sense of place, in some ways I feel like individuals too.
Oh, absolutely.
You're there, you know, just in the presence of this tree, even though it's upside down.
Yeah. I've really connected with those for some reason. Well, I know why. It's because they were made in 1990, which is also the year that I was born. So I feel like, you know, I do have this almost very like personal, because of the scale, because of the fact that they're actually, oh, they're not as big as a tree, but they're a little bit bigger than me, that they take on this human element. So I've sort of felt a kindred spirit with them, having them here.
And I really like too what you said about how different things look in different places, and actually this idea of what's it like to let go of something you've worked on and see it somewhere. It's so exciting because the works take on an entirely different life in a way, and you don't know what that's going to be, and it's just a different way to experience them. So it's actually a really wonderful thing, and especially when you did such a good job on it that, you know.
Well, I know that one of the things that I find to be so special when we send works out to other institutions is the fact that our work gets to be seen somewhere else. And, you know, I know that the Whitney has a lot of works. And so I tend to personify works of art. And so I love the idea of them like going on vacation somewhere else to meet new people.
Yes. That's great.
So we have a number of questions that have come in over the course of the presentations. Thank you, Carrie and Hillary. The first one is for you, Carrie. How large is the Whitney's photography collection, and what percentage of the Whitney's collection is photography?
Oh, gosh. I'm so sorry. I'm not very good with these kind of figures.
Guesstimate is fine.
I don't even know what to tell you off the top of my head. I don't know the percentage.
I think the question sort of drives at what is the importance of photography to the Whitney's collecting?
Well, I would say that it's become more important, and it didn't start out as a major part of the collection. And it wasn't until about sometimes in the 70s that exhibitions started occurring. And I show that picture of Charles Sheeler because Sheeler was among a group of early of artists who Gertrude Vanderbilt Whitney, who was the founder of the museum, knew and was associated with and supported, but she supported them more in terms of their painting or their work in other media, and in the case of those artists, painting. But they were also making photographs. So its importance grew in the museum's history until really later, and a little later than places like MoMA, who started quite a bit earlier. But it has a very important place now. I'm sorry I can't give you the numbers, but we have a photography exhibition up right now, which is very important. It's called Working Together, the Photographers of the Kumoyu Workshop. And it has an important place at the museum.
So Hillary had mentioned when she was introducing you that a lot of the shows that you're curating look like they have a bent towards photography. Do you have a particular interest in photography? Are you a photographer?
No, I'm not a photographer, but I do have a particular interest, and I have been involved with photography and photographers for many years, and so I have a history of working with photography, and I'm very fond of it. So
a question came in for both of the curators. Not that we want you to pick your favorite child, but is there a particular photograph in the exhibition that is your favorite, and why?
Okay, Hillary, I'm going to let you. Because this is like picking a favorite.
It is. Like, oh my gosh. Every time I get asked for a favorite, I'm like, come on. Well, first of all, I spend more than 5 minutes with any work of art and I'm bound to like fall in love with it. I'm a chronic like lover of anything that I find out a fun fact about, basically. I would probably say that I'm particularly partial to the Matthew Barney works, if only because I have had a fascination with him for over a decade. And so to be able to see those works in person is just really exciting. And it sent me down a bit of a research rabbit hole. And they're just fascinating to me. They're endlessly fascinating. And I like the fun fact about Bjork being the sitter for one of them, but it was just every moment that something came out of the crates when we were unpacking this exhibition, I was like, what's next? I mean, everything was just so exciting. There's not a work in it that I don't love for one reason or another. So
that's great.
Not a fair question.
Yeah. And I'm sorry, I can't answer it. It's, you know, I think being a curator, you tend to have, or I think most curators do, a fascination and love for what each work has,
totally.
You know, and what's special about that particular work. And certainly if you're putting them in an exhibition, you don't put them in if you're not in love with them in some way or another. So.
Well, that's the truth. That is the honest.
The next question is kind of related, but doesn't ask you to pick favorites. The images were made across a broad range of time, a period of time. And are there particular works in the exhibition that feel especially contemporary or timeless to you? Both curators, that question. Mm.
Quite frankly, I feel like all of them feel contemporary and timeless to me. You know, even though I don't know what one of the earliest ones in the show is, I'm thinking of the little Diane Arbus, perhaps.
I think that might be one of the earliest, which is just a sweet photograph.
It is.
Really darling.
And the size of it might make you feel that it's something from an earlier time, but not the image. It feels very contemporary and timeless. And I really feel like pretty much everything does. So,
well, there's such a interesting range of perspectives and styles and approaches that the artists in this exhibition employ that I think you could talk about that question in a variety of ways, and that some are entirely sort of fanciful and created of the artist's own mind, and then others are, you know, more, I mean, I wouldn't say any of them are fully documentary, but each artist sort of plays with a sense of time, I think, in a very unique way that lends itself to being of the moment in which it was made, but also more of a sort of timeless consideration.
Mm-hmm.
Although, I mean, one that feels so particularly like you are in the moment, I think, is the Robert Mapplethorpe self-portrait that was taken just before his passing, that you're really present with him, I think, in that moment. And so it is very sort of, I find that to be a particularly timeless one, too, because it's almost like an infinite moment that exists in his sort of facing of his own mortality.
Yeah. I mean, there are works that do particularly, from what you said, reminds me, speak to a time, a particular time, and I think that does. The Peter Hujar works do.
Mm-hmm.
The Robert Longos, too. I mean, he talked about it in your program, about kind of what he was after and what he was basing the look of those figures on, but even with that, they seem to really transcend that in my mind. So
thank you. So I know that this exhibition was sort of culled from a transformative gift to the Whitney from the Emily Fisher Landau collection. Mm-hmm. Can you talk a little bit about Emily Fisher Landau and her specific connection to the Whitney?
Well, she had long ties to the Whitney, and her collection is quite vast. You know, it was more than photography. It included painting and sculpture, and the gift and promised gift to the museum is more than photography. But she did, but the photography was particularly striking. And again, as I spoke about earlier, it really, in my mind, represented a particular shift in photography that occurred. But she had a wonderful, has wonderful vision, and it was wide ranging, and she has long ties to the museum.
I have a bit of a follow up question, I guess, to that. First of all, she has amazing taste in photography. Every yeah. single thing, I just would love to have one. Do you know if she was collecting as these works were being made, sort of like the way that like the Rebels collect and sort of at the moment, or is she sort of more of someone who does her research and, you know?
I'm not 100% sure, but I think that it much of it was done, was collected at the time.
Because mm-hmm, that's such yeah. a, I think of some of the great sort of collectors of our time who, yeah. or of pre, you know, of the past 100 years who were just, they have a just sense for some of these things where they just know that this yes. is, this yeah. is an object that I should have. This is an artist that I should have.
Right. Yeah. I think it was on, you know, over a reasonable period of time, and I think most was.
The next question is specifically about the Baldessari, so I'm going to bring that back up to screen. Is it up, Hillary?
Yes.
Okay. What is the relationship of the duplicate group of letters and the violin in this work?
Well, I don't think we know specifically whether he had something very specific in mind. I really think that he is playing around, or was playing around with perception. And so I think that's something, that very question is part of what the work does, is that, you know, what happens when you see this string of letters and numbers, you know, and the relationship to sound and notes and vision. I mean, that's what occurs to me. But I don't think there was a specific narrative meant in this, or a specific intention in terms of this equals that in this image. That's my understanding of it. I don't know, Hillary, if you have another take on it.
You know, I stare at this one when I'm in the galleries because it's huge, first of all. It's so right. large.
It's hard not to see it.
It's yes. so commanding, and it's such an interesting use of graphics. And I feel like John Baldessari is always like winking a little bit at you. He's always like a little bit up to something with his work. But thinking about this idea of the title in two languages, and, you know, kind of going down the classic route of what might the title make, you know, imply, mm-hmm. is that, you know, you've got the duplicating of the alphabet here, and yet it's sort of the same language, but then there's also the language of music, and then sort of our written language, and that, you know, this is the beginning of our written language here on the base of it. And I imagine there's probably a musical reference you could take in that direction too, but it's very I mean, I think it's great in the narrative section because it does just invite you to really think about there's a narrative in the image and the work itself, and there's a bit of a narrative in the back of my mind about the artist too.
Yeah.
Thank you. I've got two more questions. Does the Whitney have a large collection of Eggleston's work? I think that besides the Eggleston's, of course, that you've included in this exhibition, that there have been sort of landmark exhibitions of Eggleston's work in the past. So what is the connection between the Whitney and Eggleston?
Yeah, the Whitney does have a good collection of Eggleston's. And we did do an exhibition of Eggleston's work. I don't remember the year offhand, but, you know, it was maybe 8-10 years ago at the most. It was in the Breuer building, so it was before we moved to the new building, and did do a really extensive, wonderful exhibition of his work. So we do have a history with him.
Great. And the last question, I think is primarily for you, Carrie, although Hillary might have some ideas too. Who do you think would be some of the artists who would be in a Vantage Points 2.0 exhibition, picking up where the timeline for this one leaves off?
Oh my. That's a tough question. I guess it's maybe meant for a more contemporary view. Not quite sure exactly what the question would be. You know, I think the whole idea of using the title, I'll just say, is to suggest that there are multiple ways of seeing things. So, you know, certainly the world has changed a lot in the last few years. And of course, very contemporary photographers' work reflects that. So if it's about chronology, I would think that it would probably be reflective of a lot of the social and political changes that have occurred. But, you know, it could be any number of things. It could also have to do with the environment or all sorts of things. So it's hard to answer. I don't know, Hillary, maybe you have a dream.
Yeah, well, I think some of the things that really resonate with the work that's in this exhibition, whether it was made sort of towards the beginning of the time frame in which this work was made or towards the latter part, is that there's a real sense of, I think you're totally right, of sort of communicating what was happening in the moment for these artists and for their communities. And that I think that, you know, Vantage Points 2.0 would be looking at some of these photographers who are really looking at our communities in a lot of interesting ways, whether it's sort of more generally about sort of that great American road trip, or looking at, you know, their communities, whether they're, I mean, I feel like there's a lot of social justice elements that have come out that I think were subtly there. Like, I really love being in the room with Nan Golden and Peter Hujar and Catherine Opie and Robert Mapplethorpe, because they were sort of living in a time that a lot of elements of their life were not socially accepted, and yet they were making this beautiful work and capturing it. And I think that that's sort of always such an incredible part of what art does for us, mm-hmm. is capturing these moments. And I think the photographers come to it with a particular set of tools that makes it a very interesting way of going about that. And so, yeah, I totally think that it's in that capturing of the spirit of our moment. And that timelessness somehow still always manages to extend back or forth. And this idea of vantage points, I just love with photography in particular, because this idea of the photographer standing behind their camera, setting up the image that they want to present to mm-hmm. the viewer, that's sort of, this is their story, and yet they're also giving it to you for it to be your story, for you to step into that spot as the person behind the lens to see it through your own eyes and experiences. So I think that might be it for our questions. So I'd like to thank Carrie so much for being here with us tonight and for working with us over the last couple of months to realize this exhibition and to just be a part of the programming for it, to give us such a wonderful perspective into the works in it. It's been wonderful, and we're so grateful for your time. At this point, I'd like to hand it over to Christy for some parting information about upcoming events.
Thank you, Hillary and Carrie, and of course, all of you for joining us tonight virtually. We'll be sending out an evaluation to collect your feedback on this evening's program, so please watch your email. The museum is currently open for visitors. We're operating at reduced capacity and have a number of COVID-19 safety measures in place. You can learn more about those safety measures, as well as our current and upcoming exhibitions, virtual programs, and small group in-person offerings at ashevilleart.org. And if you enjoyed tonight's program, please consider making a donation to our annual fund or becoming a museum member. Please also mark your calendars for our upcoming in-conversation programs. Next Tuesday, so just in a few days, on March the 2nd, our guest is Ben Shapiro, director of the film Gregory Crudson, Brief Encounters. Mr. Shapiro will discuss his interest in the photographer Gregory Crudson, whose work is featured in Vantage Points, the process of making the film, and we'll take questions from the audience. Later this spring, the curators of two of our special exhibitions will join us. On March the 25th, Scott Schweigert from the Reading Public Museum will discuss Across the Atlantic, American Impressionism Through the French Lens, which is currently on view at the museum through Hillary, mid-May, I think. I should know that, actually, sorry.
April, I should too, probably.
April 19th is sticking in my mind. And on April the 22nd, Stephen Wicks from the Knoxville Museum of Art will discuss Beaufort Delaney's Metamorphosis into Freedom. These programs are posted on our website. For more information and to register, visit ashevilleart.org. Many thanks to Art Bridges for its generous sponsorship of tonight's program and all of the In Conversation virtual talks that we have on the horizon. We hope to see you in the galleries or at another virtual program through our Museum from Home initiative. Thank you all for your support. Stay well and have a great rest of your week.